Hello everybody. Welcome all of you from all around the world to the release webinar of WSO2's Enterprise Integrator for the release of 7.1.0. I'm Sasikala Kottagoda, an associate technical lead of the integration team of WSO2, and I'll be accompanied by Prabhushi Samarakol, who is also an associate technical lead of the team. And later on, Sajit will be taking on, and he's a technical lead of the of our team. So please feel free to add in your questions in the questions tab of the GoToWebinar panel. And also note that we will be sending the recordings of this webinar as well as the slides to all of you as a follow-up mail. Before going into the details, I'll be taking through today's agenda. So the first part will be conducted by me on the improvements that have been done to the micro integrator component of the enterprise integrator. And I'll be first describing the support we have introduced for both the centralized deployments and microservices-based deployments in the micro-integrator. And then I'll be introducing you the all-new observability solution that we have introduced in this release, which is based on Grafana, Prometheus, Jaeger, and Loki. The next half will be conducted by Prabhushi, and she'll be taking you through the changes we have made to the integration studio. So she'll basically tell you the improvements that we have done to the CI/CD pipeline, the new connectors that have been introduced to the Integration Studio, and the improvements that have been done to the Integration Studio's UI and the connector configuration waves. The last part will be conducted by Sajit, and he'll be taking you through the improvements that we have done to the streaming integrator in the perspective of supporting change data capture, file scraping, and flow monitoring. So for those who know about WSO2's Enterprise Integrator and for those who don't know, I'll just briefly explain you what Enterprise Integrator 7.1.0 is. So basically, if you are somebody with requirements such as SaaS integrations, file integrations, SOA kind of integrations, or microservices or data integrations, so you will be looking into the micro integrator component of WSO2's Enterprise Integrator. And if you're somebody with the requirements of streaming, having streaming ETL or event stream integrations, you'll be looking into the streaming integrator component of WSO2's Enterprise Integrator. So all both these integration components are accompanied by designer studios that are particularly designed for them. So the integration studio is particularly developed for you to implement your artifacts, develop them, test them, and deploy them inside the micro integrator seamlessly. And in the same way, streaming integrator tooling is particularly designed so that you can develop your artifacts that are to be used with the streaming integrator. So the micro integrator is not completely a new product. It's based on the popular Synapse engine that has been there in the market for more than a decade. So it has been in the market since the year 2009, to be precise, and it has been used by different commercial and open source integration vendors. So it is the same old ESB you know, but in a new phase. It is more user-friendly, it has more capabilities, it is a lot less bulky, and it comes with several optimizations so that you can use it for any kind of integrations, whether it be SOA kind of conventional integrations or microservices. So this release of Micro Integrator 1.2.0, which is the integrator component of the Enterprise Integrator 7.1.0, was mainly focused on optimizing the runtime for both centralized and container native deployments. So MI was originated with the mindset of it being used only in the containerized environments. But later, we received so many queries saying that they wanted to use this product in centralized deployments, and we decided to make it scalable and extensible. So while making it scalable and extensible, we also made sure that improvements are consistently made to it so that its cloud-native characteristics are preserved still. And we have done many improvements in that aspect as well. So to tell you what improvements that we have done to the centralized deployments, we have basically one of the biggest features we have introduced is the RDBMS based coordination mechanism, which allows you to have a concept of having a set of nodes which are working in a coordinated way, having the concept of a cluster rather. And then we have also done a massive enhancements to the integration dashboard. And then we have brought back the feature of hot deployment to make the developer's life easier. One of the major reasons that the previous version of MI wasn't capable of being used in VM deployments was because it was unable to work in a coordinated way. Those versions 1.0.0 or 1.1.0 had no concept of clustering, and they worked in as individual units. So if in case you deploy a task in two nodes, MI would be executing those tasks as individual units, and they will be performing duplicated work rather than working in a coordinated way. We saw this as a major drawback in the previous releases, because in VM deployments, you need to scale up your deployment and work in a coordinated way. So in this release, we introduced an RDBMS-based coordination mechanism so that the nodes can communicate with each other through the database. Coordination works with a leader election mechanism, where a node in the cluster is elected as the master, leader, or the coordinator, whatever you call it. And then it takes the ownership of the whole cluster and manages it. So it basically notifies other nodes when a new node joins, or when an older node leaves the node. So it makes sure that all the nodes in the cluster are in sync with the cluster state. It is also the one who decides which node runs a particular task when you deploy it, and who takes it up if the node that was executing that task goes down. So thus, it takes care of the high availability aspect, and it also makes sure that there is no work duplication. One thing to note is that because all the communication happens through the DB, the database becomes a single point of failure here. So if the connection to the database is lost, every single node stops performing its coordinated tasks, and they stay until the connection is retrieved back. Once again, you need to know that only the coordinated tasks will stop. Other services which are not coordinated will continue to run. The minimum HA deployment of an MI cluster becomes two nodes with this approach, because we do not have a concept of network. Basically, there are no internode communications through the network, so we don't have the concept of having quorums or anything. So you can just have two nodes as your minimum HA deployment. So let's see how you'd configure a cluster with this all-new approach. You think that there'll be a whole lot of configurations, but it's just a matter of adding this data source. You need to add this data source with the ID WSO2 coordination DB, but the rest of it is pretty much the connection details. You'll be configuring the database URL, the username and the password and the driver. So these are pretty much the details you would give to connect to any database. Once you give these details and run the server, the runtime will take care of the rest for you. So it'll appoint a coordinator and start executing the tasks whenever you deploy those tasks. So when I say it, the coordinator will start scheduling tasks in a coordinated way. There are multiple ways a task could be scheduled, and in the default mode, they'll be scheduled in an HA mode, rather an active passive mode, where a single node will be picked up as the active node to execute all the tasks that are deployed. And once that node goes down, another node will be appointed as the active node to pick up the task. Also, we have this round robin resources where you want to load balance the task, and we have the capability of pinning tasks to a single node or a particular set of nodes. And regarding the enhancements we have done to the integrated dashboard, so basically you can open the dashboard and you'll be able to see the difference. So basically the micro integrated dashboard, which was packed with the previous releases, was also known as the monitoring dashboard, because you were only capable of observing, or rather viewing, the deployed artifacts that are deployed in a single node. There was nothing you could do beyond that. But With the introduction of the new integrated dashboard in this release, you can manage these artifacts in the sense of you can activate them or deactivate them. And in addition, you can manage log files, log configurations, or uses. So you can now download server logs from the dashboard. This is because as a result of a number of queries we have received saying that the developers did not have access to the server instances to view logs. We saw this as a time-consuming task where because they had to contact the DevOps parties to retrieve the logs whenever they wanted. So what we have done is we have made their lives easier because now you can just simply open your integration dashboard and view the log files and download the log files whenever you want. And with this new addition, you can view update to add loggers. This is particularly useful when you face issues in the server runtime where you need additional logs without having to restart the server. And you can just simply toggle the log levels or add the loggers you want and view the log changes. In this release, you can view, add, and delete users. The support is very basic at the moment, and you can just only play with users. You can manage users, but not rows for the moment. So the key thing we saw that drove us to bring this feature back was that developers had to keep restarting the server for every single change they do for an artifact. It's not about a whole composite application, but you know they just probably do a single change to a single artifact. And having to restart the server just for this was pretty much too much. It adds the server startup time and the time to deploy other artifacts which could be totally irrelevant. So to make their lives easier, we brought in hot deployment so that they can simply redeploy the composite application or the artifacts that are required with the necessary changes, and the redeployment happens in no time. This is enabled by default in the pack because we wanted to make the developer's life easier. We did not want you to do any more configurations to have this enabled. But we saw that this disturbs the nature of immutability in containers. So we have disabled this in the Docker image. To take you through the optimizations that we have done for container deployments, we have introduced a readiness probe. This is a vital configuration in Kubernetes because this is what tells the Kubernetes container management system whether the server is ready to receive a request or not. So basically, this is required so that your requests are routed. In the previous releases, what we had to do was we had to ask the customers to write their own API so that it can be used as the readiness probe. But with this release, we have introduced an API to be used as the readiness probe, and it goes to the ready state if the server starts up without any problem and there are no faulty artifacts. Then we have brought in the support for Docker and Kubernetes secrets. We have also revamped the vault experience we had in the previous releases. We have introduced the concept of static and dynamic secrets, where the Docker image is built with the static secrets burnt into it, and you can look up to dynamic secrets at the runtime. We have also introduced Docker images based on CentOS and Ubuntu-based images. This is for the runtime. And we have also introduced Docker images for the dashboard based on the same base images. And we have introduced an all-new observability solution in this release. And that is basically based on Grafana dashboards. And it's made possible by Prometheus, Jega, and Loki integrations. So once you open your Grafana dashboard, once you configure Grafana to work with the integrator runtime, you'll be presented with a cluster-wide summary. You will be shown the node count in the cluster, the service count that are deploying, and then you will be shown the node list and the service list, and it'll basically give you a summary of the request count and the error count that you have. And from that view, you can either click on nodes or services. If you click on the node dashboard, this is what you would be getting. It'll give you the uptime. That means the time that
time since the server has started and the server service count that are deployed in that particular node, and it will give you a summary of the requests that have been managed by this particular instance. So alternatively, if you click on a service rather than a node, it will give you the same similar kind of statistics. It will give you the time since the service has been deployed, and it will be giving you the time, the latency details, and the requests and the error counts, and so many more. So basically, this is made possible via the integration with Prometheus. MI exposes an API so that the Prometheus server can scrape statistics from it. And as the metrics that we expose the request count, the request error counts, latencies, WSO2 server uptimes, and the WSO2 service uptimes. Then if you see a little bit below, you can see the logs being loaded. So this is made possible by the integration of Fluentbit and Loki. Fluentbit has the agent responsible for gathering logs and sending them to Loki. Loki acts as the main server where it is responsible for storing logs and processing your queries. Basically, you can execute any kind of a filtering query that you need, and you can troubleshoot logs whenever you need. And end-to-end tracing capabilities with Jaeger also have been introduced in this release. It will show you how a message flows through the Synapse artifacts, the time spent on a particular set of mediators, and it will show them as a span. And it's made possible by a Jaeger client, which starts publishing data to the server upon enabling tracing. So as to the other improvements, we have totally revamped the RabbitMQ implementation so that you can have a smoother integration with RabbitMQ. We have also introduced a transaction counter for services, and this will give you a rough idea on the number of transactions that you have handled for a particular time period. We have also introduced the read-write support for user stores, which means that the previous versions of MI was capable of being used with use external user stores, but you could only connect to them in a read-only mode. In this release, you can connect to them in a read-write mode and manage the users as I have shown earlier. Then we have brought in the capability of dynamically updating log configuration so that you don't have to restart the server anymore. You can either do this via the dashboard as I have shown earlier, or you can simply change the log file and wait for the changes to be in effect. Then we have also brought in the capability of exposing your data services as Swagger definitions. You can basically let the server generate Swagger definitions for you, or you can expose your own Swagger definition whenever you want. We have also done improvements for the CLI in par with the improvements that we have done for the integrated dashboard, so that the users can have a better experience with the CLI. And these are just a little bit of improvements we have done. So if you want to see what many more improvements that we have done for the release, please feel free to look into our release tag. So the next half will be continued by Prabhushi on the improvements that we have done for the Integration Studio.
So let's quickly dive into what Integration Studio, which is the tooling support provider for WSO2 Micro Integrator, brings in for this 7.10 release of WSO2 Enterprise Integrator. So as previously mentioned by Sasikala, WSO2 Micro Integrator introduces new capabilities for both centralized and container deployments with this release. So if we look at the packaging of Integration Studio distribution, we have included basically everything that you need to develop and test a centralized integration solution within this Integration Studio itself. So we have embedded the latest version of Micro Integrator and the latest version of Micro Integrator monitoring dashboard, along with the Apache Maven and JDK 1.8. So all you need to do is just download the Integration Studio and start developing your integration solution. And if you need to test on a containerized environment, such as Docker or Kubernetes, Integration Studio provides all the developer capabilities that are required you to configure any WSO2 integrator on such environment. So one of the main focuses of this release was to ease the CI/CD workflow for any DevOps engineer when building an integration solution with WSO2 microintegrator. So to cater to those requirements, we have introduced the integration project, which wraps all the children project modules under a parent project. Here, the children project modules are the same as before that are being used to create integration artifacts, such as our ESP configs module, composite exporter module, the Docker exporter module, etc., which we use to create integration artifacts. So along with that introduction of integration project, we came up with four different Maven profiles to this parent project to enable project building with a single Maven command execution. For example, the default Maven profile of this Maven profiles can be used to build and create deployables with your integration artifacts for a centralized deployment. And if you use this Docker profile, you can generate a custom Docker image incorporating all your integration artifacts. And also, you can push the generated Docker image to a remote repository as you prefer. So all these can be done using a single Maven command execution using this integration project and Maven profiles model. So additionally, if you already have any project modules which are created using one of our previous versions of Integration Studio, the new release provides an option to migrate them into an integration project so that you can continue with your CI/CD workflow. So one of the painful areas that we identified with the previous versions was the limitations when it comes to testing and debugging your integration solutions with the embedded microintegrator. So in order to improve the user experience of that area, we made several changes for our embedded server configuration. As this Integration Studio 7.1.0 comes with our microintegrator 1.2.0, the embedded server was adjusted to support the hot deployment capabilities introduced with the 1.2.0 release of MI. And also, along with that, we introduced a new wizard to allow configuring the embedded server via the Integration Studio itself. For example, if you want to develop a JMS consumer, you know, we have to introduce the JMS transport related configurations as well as the related broker client jars into the server. So now with the introduction of new wizard, all these servers TOML based configurations and custom library additions can be managed with this wizard. And Integration Studio handles the hot deployment capabilities internally while you are doing testing or debugging your artifacts. And it restarts the server if you have made any changes via this introduced wizard. If not, it hot deploys your artifacts into the server. Moving on, we have the Sun Runtime Services view to get the details of services that are being deployed in the embedded server. So now you can simply copy the endpoint URLs of a particular service using this view, and you can use the HTTP client of the Integration Studio to invoke them. And also, we embedded the monitoring dashboard into Integration Studio, which can also be easily accessed via this runtime services view to retrieve further information about deployed services. Another major area that was improved with this release is WSO2 connector. We have newly introduced several connectors, including a connector specific for CSV transformation. This connector is presented as a set of utility functions to easily perform any customization while doing the transformation. For example, you can exclude a set of columns or exclude a range of rows, or even you can order the rows depending on the data values that are there in a particular column while doing a CSV to JSON transformation. So in addition to that, we introduced a new email connector, which wraps all the generic capabilities of email service providers into a single connector. So besides these, we made major code level changes to our generic connection pooling and to the refresh token flow, and revamped the functionality and the performance of several other connectors, including our Salesforce connector, Amazon S3, Kafka, etc. So with the introduction of improvements to these connectors, we introduce a new properties view for connectors for this integration studio with the local entry based connection configuration. So with this introduction of new connection configuration, we can have dynamic connection configurations as well as we can reuse them for each for different functions of the connector. So in addition to above, the getting started page was given a new look and feel with the categorized sample. So now you can learn how to construct a message routing scenario or a data integration scenario, or you can learn how to write a Synapse unit test for your integration scenario using the provided samples in Integration Studio. So all these samples were revamped to support the introduced integration project model so that you can learn best practices along with the sample. Also, you are provided with quick access to our documentation, video tutorials and webinars, and also to our Slack channel on this getting started page if you need further help on this matter. In addition to that, several other editor UI improvements were made in this release, including our data services editor. A more intuitive new theme was introduced to improve the user experience while creating the data services using the Integration Studio. And also, there were several functionality improvements done for our AI-based data mapping, with the introduction of new UI fixes as well as this new user confirmation view. The overall theme of the Integration Studio was revamped along with new icons and colors. So with the introduction of the new theme, this makes the IDE more user-friendly, and it also enhances the look and feel of the wizards and dialog boxes that are there in Integration Studio. And also with the theme, we introduced a new update notification model to identify you with the availability of new fixes and improvements so that you can always keep your Integration Studio up to date. And also we added an option to identify to report any issues and to get any customer feedback so that we can identify the areas that are needed to be improved based on your valuable feedback. So the mentions are basically the main highlights of the Integration Studio 7.1.0 release. In addition to them, there are lots of other bug fixes, UI fixes, functionality and performance improvements that are coming along with this release. So you can check more details about them if you visit our Integration Studio Git repository. So now let's move on to the details of the new release of our WS2 streaming integrator. So Sajit will continue from here on.
Thank you, Prabhushi. So I'll be talking about WS2 streaming integrated component, which is the latest addition to the WS2 EI product family. And also I'll be talking about like what features that is being included as part of this new release to the streaming integration runtime of WS2 EI. So for those who are not familiar with the streaming integrator, so the streaming integration runtime is actually the successor of the WSO2 stream processor product that was shipped as a separate product several years ago. So WSO2 stream processor was predominantly focusing on streaming analytics. WSO2 streaming integrator is also using the same engine as WSO2 stream processor, but it is empowered and equipped with more tools and more features that will let users use streaming in runtime for more integration use cases. So if I talk briefly about its capabilities, so it can receive streams of data that is being published. And one of the unique features of streaming integrator is it can also extract data in real time. So this effectively turns a passive data store or data that is resting on a disk to a stream of flowing events. So this way it can treat any data source as a stream. And then these streams can be processed using various stream processing techniques, which the streaming integrator inherits by the IO stream processing engine. So we classify it under six main categories: transform, insights, cleanse, enrich, aggregate, and correlate. And once the streams are processed, these streams can again be published to consumers who expect data as a stream of events, or rather load it or write it back to a disk or even to a cloud storage. So now let me introduce what's being newly added to the WSO2 streaming integrator as part of this new release. So the theme for the streaming runtime for this release is actually making streaming integrator as an effective tool for streaming ETL. So in essence, we are doing extract, transformation, and loading, but in a streaming manner, meaning that the data will be extracted on real time, transformed on real time, and also loaded real time, in contrast to the batch mode of execution of traditional ETL. So in order to enable users more, or in order to make users' lives easy to build streaming ETL kind of scenarios, we have done changes in many fronts. So let me quickly list through them initially, and then I'll describe each of these to you. So the first, so we have done enhancements in our tooling, which lets users develop a simple streaming ETL flow with actually writing no code. And also we are introducing data flow monitoring, which gives stats and figures about your data flows or streaming ETL flows at different levels. And also we are bringing in inbuilt support for error capturing and event or data replaying to achieve zero data loss. And you know that WSO2 streaming integrator is like it's an extensible product, so all the external connectivity is plugged in as extensions. So now we are introducing extension installation assistant, which will let you manage your extensions very easily, eliminating any manual installation steps. And also we are bringing in several new connectors as well. So highlights will be the Azure Data Lake connector, the Change Data Capture connector for MongoDB and File System Event Listener. Okay, let's go into details, a little bit of details of the major features that we are introducing. Okay. The first one I would like to talk about is the streaming ETL task result. So streaming integration runtime also comes with it. Own tooling, which is a web-based graphical IDE. So far we've been supporting source editing and also a drag and drop sort of a flow editor. But here we are with this, we are introducing an ETL task wizard, which lets user go through six simple steps and then build an ETL flow only by providing the required configuration. So this task wizard is like, it's graphical and also it's self-documented. So the users can very easily, even with the user with very little knowledge about the CTO streaming can use this task insert to build an ETL flow. And then we are introducing a monitoring solution for ETL flows. So underneath we are using Prometheus and Grafana. What you are seeing here is actually the stats shown for a change data capture data source. Actually it provides you stats at different levels, at system level, at integration ETL flow level, as well as the subcomponents of the ETL flow. So this will allow users to very easily identify what are the performance of your system and how is your system behaving, and also profile the data sources and destinations that you are connecting. Another important features that we are bringing in is event replay and error story. So event replay, let me talk about the error story part first. So there can be events that are resulting in errors. Some of these errors might be logical errors or network level errors or some error in the payload, etc. So in a streaming scenario especially, you are processing large amounts of data, so sometimes you might even not notice that your data is being lost or dropped. So this error storing capability lets you configure your integration to capture such events which are erroneous and then store it for to be reconciled later. So and then that's where the event replay part comes in. So once that erroneous event is stored, the user can go through the list of erroneous events and then look into the details as shown in this screen, look into the details and then replay the event after doing the necessary modifications to its payload. So this will enable you to achieve zero data loss even with a single node. And finally, the extension installation functionality. So extension installation is actually is a sort of a convenience feature that we are bringing in. So as I explained earlier, all the connect to the external system is plugged into streaming integrators extensions or connectors. So installing the connections usually required you to download the jar, and also not only that jar, and also the other third party dependencies by browsing through different pages. But with this feature, you only now you can install any connector by issuing a single click or with just a single command. So this makes the life very easy for you to when it comes to managing the connectors. So that's all about streaming integrator. So now let's move on to the questions. So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask.
So we have received a question asking whether we have Helm resources for the micro integrator. Yes, we have prepared Helm resources for this release. It was not available before this, but for this release, we have prepared Helm resources and they'll be released out soon. By the way, we are absolutely sorry about the audio issues you have encountered. Please bear with us for the low quality of the audio. There's a question asking whether we can expect soon a common log file for a clustered environment rather, right? So it's not there yet. It's not there yet. You're not there in this release. So basically, we have this plan of enhancing the dashboard to be able to be more than a more of a control plane, so that you know you can connect to multiple nodes. And you know you can have a cluster-wide view with the integrated dashboard. So with that, you can expect a common log while as well.
So we are getting another issue asking question actually asking what are the remote repositories that we can use to push a Docker image via the using the Docker or Kubernetes project in Integration Studio. So basically the default repository that is used is the Docker Hub, and also we have tested with Red Hat key.io and OpenShift registries. You can basically push the Docker images to any repository that supports our pattern that is defined in our project, that is the URL slash username and the repository name.
So there is another question asking whether we have a recommended infrastructure, basically a recommended deployment YAML files for DKE. So what we have planned for this release is actually to simply release the Helm resources. We have also introduced a Kubernetes operator so that it goes with the recommended set of configurations. And so you could pick between the Kubernetes operator and the Helm resources for this release.
So there's a question asking whether the Integration Studio allows remote connection to WS2 API Manager to publish sequence flows. With the current Integration Studio, we don't have that capability. But I think from the API Manager side, they have their own Eclipse-based tooling support to push their sequence artifacts to API Manager. So you can basically use that studio that is also based on Eclipse. So there's another question asking whether we can deploy a Carbon application to a remote server via Integration Studio. Yes, you can deploy Carbon applications using our add server option. With this release, we are actually supporting MI120 server as well. So you can select any of our EIO MI server from there.
So there's another question asking about the compatibility of the Kafka inbound endpoint. So basically the recommendation of the newer versions of the integrator, micro integrator, is to use the Kafka custom Kafka endpoint you see in the connector store rather than the default Kafka endpoint. You can use the custom Kafka endpoint in the connector store. You can download it and use it, and it will work with the newer versions.
I think there's a question asking what are the databases that we support for change data capturing streaming integrator. So we support Oracle, MySQL, MS SQL, MongoDB, and Postgres.
So there's another question asking, can we use the new updated connectors in EI66 server? Yes, you can. Actually, all the mentioned are already released to our connector store. So you can, if you're using the Integration Studio, you can use the option to connect to our store and get the connector from our store.
So basically, there's another question asking what are the circumstances we should consider migrating to 710 from 6xx. So basically, you can migrate from 6xx to Micro Integrator 120, and that is actually the recommended approach going forward. However, there would be, so we have extensive migration guides to support you here. So you'd be following them, and you'd be starting. It is actually recommended for you to start migrating to Micro Integrator 120 from EI66 versions.
So this I think this question is about CDIO. So the question is like, does the streaming integrator is consisting of all the capabilities that the CDIO open source project has? So actually the streaming integrator uses CDIO as its core, So therefore, all the core functionalities of CTIO is there, but the CTIO project had some capabilities around like providing a distributed deployment in Kubernetes environment. So, but that we don't inherit that functionality, but all the stream processing capabilities and all the connectors that is being developed for CTIO is also compatible with Stream Unity.
That's another question asking whether we have Hazelcast clustering anymore. So basically, due to the number of issues we faced in the previous releases, EI6XX, we have moved away from Hazelcast, and the newer version is completely dependent on the database, the RDBMS database.
So there's another question asking if we have in the Integration Studio 7.0.2 already, do we need to take an update to get the newest version of, I think, the 7.1.0. So basically, if you take the updates, you can get all the UI changes for your Integration Studio 7.0.2 as well. Basically, the updater model works as all the 7XXX will get all the UI related fixes. But the thing is, the internal runtime, the server runtime that is being packed for the distribution won't be changed with that update. So if you take the update, you will be having our MI110 with all the new UI changes. So what we recommend is you to download the new version of Integration Studio, and you can actually use your previous workspace and continue with your previous state of your flow.
So there's another question asking about the enhancement we have done for RabbitMQ in this release. So basically, the RabbitMQ transport was completely rewritten. If you have used RabbitMQ with the previous releases, you would have seen that there is no way of supporting a dual channel scenario, or rather we have made use of the DLQ extensively in this release, and we have actually completely rewritten it in a way that it's less, you will feel less issues while integrating the MI with RabbitMQ.
Okay, so this question is about like how do we compare the streaming integrator with Kafka. The streaming integrator and Kafka are kind of playing in the same use cases, but Kafka I would say is more of a broker, a log-based event broker, so its capabilities are more oriented towards delivering of events and distribution of events as an event broker. Whereas also, of course, the KSQL is also consisting of some pre-processing capabilities as well. But on the other hand, Streaming Integrator has no event brokering capabilities. So it's rather more of an event processing engine. So what it can do is it can consume events and process, and then again integrate again with or publish to an endpoint. So therefore, they are not actually competing projects, rather they are complementing projects, where the Kafka is an event broker delivering mechanism, and Streaming Integrator is a stream processing engine which will process events and enrichment.
There's another question asking whether it's possible to populate EI logs to Logstash server. So at the moment, there is no out of the box way, but you can configure FileBeat to pull logs and publish them to Logstash. That is the way for the moment. Somebody is also asking whether WSO2MI120 and WSO2MI710 is the same. Basically, 710 is the version of the Enterprise Integrator. MI is just a component of it, and the runtime version of MI is 120, and the runtime version of Streaming Integrator, that is SI, is 110, but altogether we call it the 710, which is the EI release. So it
So, okay, there's a last minute question that has come in. Somebody's asking whether the message broker is a separate component. Yes, so message broker was shipped as a profile in the previous releases. Those are the 6xx releases of EI, but the 7xx range of releases of the EI does not pack it. You only get it in the EI 6xx versions. So it seems like there are no more questions coming in. So we will have to wrap up. So thanks for joining this webinar. And so if we have left any of your questions unanswered, we will make sure that we answer them separately to you in a mail. And we will send you a follow-up mail thread on the recording of this webinar and the slide set. So thank you very much for joining us.